Few aspects of the Second World War have been so misunderstood, misrepresented, and pushed into near mythology as the Luftwaffe's test programs. Their discussion in less academic circles is dominated by rampant speculation from those who indulge in sensationalist historical stories. With respect to that, one might be surprised to find the bizarre photographs of a Spitfire Mk 5B with the Daimler Benz engine to be one of the few remaining genuine artifacts from an obscure Luftwaffe program. With so little information publicly available, naturally, the odd plane's origins, purpose, and performance have been drowned in a sea of speculation. However, while it is often erroneously claimed that the so-called Messerschmitt was some bizarre attempt to combine the best aspects of the two planes, in reality, the aircraft was converted to settle a technical argument which had been raging in the Luftwaffe research and development circles since 1942. The history of fighter engine development is one of ceaseless improvement in power and weight, which are largely achieved through improving methods of design, production, and the use of better materials. In the case of the Luftwaffe, it was not long until the chase for power was subsumed by the need to develop engines which could run more reliably on inferior materials. Following the end of the Battle of Britain, the Luftwaffe soon found itself short of several key materials necessary in building heat and corrosion-resistant alloys, most notably nickel, tin, and later, chromium and cobalt. In order to cope with the restricted access to these materials, economy alloys were introduced to ensure the aviation industry would have access to enough materials, albeit ones which would cause a slate of problems. The first serious problems were encountered in the BF-109F. The new production DB-601N engines relied on the new alloys and a synthetic fuel, which they had not been tested for. These engines were both fragile, and the rubber fuel tanks degraded the high performance qualities of the synthetic fuel. Eventually, these problems would be sorted out, but only after a lengthy investigation. Problems would resurface again when it came time to re-engine the 109 with the new DB605A. Developed from the DB601E, the new engine was to be a marked improvement. However, new material restrictions would sharply curtail the use of molybdenum, tungsten, and especially cobalt. Problems new and old emerged, the most egregious of which were exhaust valve failures due to the low nickel content of the components, resulting in rapid corrosion and crackling. The first Gustavs would enter service in early 1942, though they soon had the performance limited, off and on, to prevent engine failure rates from reaching unmanageable levels. As a result of these limitations, the Gustav was initially slower than the plane it was supposed to replace, and finally received clearances for emergency power almost 2 years after the first Gustav left the factory. Continued development of the BF-109 was in a very precarious place, as performance improvements were expected without any major increases in engine power. Willy Messerschmitt would place the blame with Daimler Benz, whose engines, he claimed, had cooling requirements that were too high, and thus required the use of larger drag-inducing radiators. In part, he was correct, but he was also shifting attention away from his firm's radiator designs. His radiators operated under comparatively low pressure and lower efficiency, a drawback in making them more robust. In 1942, Messerschmitt began an increasingly adversarial correspondence with Fritz Nallinger of Daimler Benz, and would request that he redesign the engine to run at higher temperatures. In a letter sent in December of that year, he would draw a comparison between the ailing DB605A and the powerful Merlin 61, then in service with the RAF. He placed particular emphasis on the higher operating temperatures and its use of radiators that were 55% smaller than those in service on the BF-109. He would leave out that British aircraft designers installed high-pressure radiators far more efficient than his own. At a conference with Goering in Karinhall in March of 1943, Messerschmitt would openly lay blame on Daimler Benz and Nallinger, largely reiterating the points from his previous correspondence. By the end of the meeting, it had become clear that both men would need to work against one another to defend their own reputations. To prove Messerschmitt wrong, Nallinger proposed a simple and clear demonstration. He would install one of the firm's engines in a Spitfire to show that the DB605A did not require a large radiator to run. The Spitfire in question was EN830, a Mark 5B which had crash-landed in the German-occupied Jersey Islands in November of 1942. Its pilot, Sous-Lieutenant Bernard Scheinhauer, crash-landed his plane after being struck by ground fire during a rhubarb raid over northern France, and a fuel leak prevented him from returning to Britain. After ditching his plane, Lieutenant Scheinhauer attempted to destroy the aircraft. However, there was insufficient fuel to burn the Spitfire. Scheinhauer was subsequently sent to Stalag Luft 3 in Poland. He was among those murdered by the Gestapo after the legendary mass escape. The plane was subsequently taken in hand by the Luftwaffe and used for trials at Recklin Test Center. It was later pulled from storage for Nallinger's tests sometime in late 1943. The plane was re-engined with a DB605A, and its armament and radio were removed. All of the work was done at the Daimler Benz Untertürkheim factory in Stuttgart, after which it was delivered to the Luftwaffe for testing at the nearby airfield at Echterdingen. Testing began in the spring of 1944, with the flight report on the aircraft being finished May 10th. The plane flew quite well, and proved Nallinger right in that the DB605A could work using a significantly smaller radiator area. It also made for an interesting comparison with the BF-109's radiators, as it was found that the high-pressure model fitted to the Spitfire Mk 5 was 50% smaller but provided only 4% less cooling capacity. The tests also showed that the Messerschmitt was about 25 kilometers an hour faster at lower altitudes than the original Spitfire Mk 5B, thanks to its fluid coupling supercharger, which proved more efficient at low altitude. The hybrid aircraft proved to be 10 to 20 kilometers per hour slower than a BF-109G6 at all altitudes, save for above 10.5 kilometers, where the Messerschmitt held a slightly higher service ceiling. The experimental aircraft also outclimbed the BF-109 at all altitudes. However, this was largely a given, as the aircraft was unarmed. While Daimler-Benz did have issues increasing the output of their engines, these tests conclusively proved that Messerschmitt's claims regarding the necessity of larger radiators was, in fact, false. With the point proven, the aircraft was placed in storage and was likely written off after an 8th Air Force bombing raid on the airfield at Echterdingen in August of 1944. Unfortunately, due to this unique aircraft's strange appearance of obscurity, it has been at the center of a number of bizarre theories. Perhaps the most popular of these theories is that the Germans were trying to build a plane that blended the strengths of both the Spitfire and the BF-109. Some go as far as to claim that the Germans had managed to build something superior to both. This first theory can be immediately written off. By early 1944, neither the BF-109 nor the Spitfire were considered state-of-the-art or at the forefront of design in either country. They simply would not be considered an acceptable starting point for any new aircraft design. However, beyond that, the Messerschmitt's performance was unimpressive. In the official tests, it was compared to both an early Spitfire Mk 5B, which was thoroughly obsolete by the end of 1943, and a BF-109G6, which was mediocre by the standards of early 1944. Even then, it compared rather poorly with the G6, and in late 1942, the Mk 5B had received engine clearances that eliminated the performance gap at low altitude. Compared to other contemporary frontline fighters of its day, its performance was far less impressive. The Spitfire Mk 9, with its Merlin 66, comprehensively outperformed the hybrid. While the aircraft did demonstrate a very high climb rate, this can be explained by the lack of any weapons on board. Without these and its radio, it was 300 kilograms lighter than it was pre-modification. In the end, despite being a fusion of the BF-109 and Spitfire, it compared rather poorly to either one. Another theory presupposes that the plane was part of an effort to actually produce Spitfires for the Luftwaffe. The foundations for nearly all these claims rest with an often misunderstood quote from the Battle of Britain. When Reichsmarschall Hermann Göring asked Fighter Group Commander Adolf Galland if there was anything he needed, Galland responded, "I should like an outfit of Spitfires for my squadron." Galland would later clarify in his memoirs that he meant this rhetorically. In truth, he wanted a plane which would serve better as a bomber escort, something he felt the RAF Spitfires were better suited to, with their better visibility and low-speed handling than his own BF-109s, which he felt were more capable on offensive patrols. In the end, the Messerschmitt was built to serve a single, fairly mundane purpose. It was never meant to set records, achieve any kind of technical breakthrough, or somehow be an unbeatable synthesis of two planes that already seen their day in the sun. Above all, it was never meant to see combat nor produce a plane that would. It did, however, serve its sole purpose as a means of combating criticism against Daimler Benz from Messerschmitt.